just in, the state of California has just officially changed its name to State of Emergency.
This just in. New York's cockroaches have hired a prominent ad agency to change their image. They will now be called Huckabugs.
This is Howard Stern. I want to apologize to the following groups. Latinos, Native Americans, and Mothers Against Drunk Drivers. I guess the only one I can make fun of is that fat film critic, Jay Sherman.
This just in, the state of California has just officially changed its name to State of Emergency.
The following is a test of Faye Dunaway's vocal cords. We repeat, this is only a test.
Hello?
Hello, this is the Fox Network. Yeah, we just want to say we are thrilled to have you with us, big guy. Wait a minute, did I call John Madden that stupid cartoon critic?
Jay, this is the Fox Network with a little advice. At the beginning of each show, why don't you write on a chalkboard like Bart? And could you change your name to Homer? And wear an 8-foot-tall blue wig like Marge? And how would you feel about sucking on a pacifier?
Jay, this is your inner child. I escaped and I just robbed a liquor store. Gotta go.
Jay, this is Manhattan Magazine. We've got some responses to your personal ad. No, 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 and no.
Jay, this is your pharmacist. Instead of Hair Restorer, we accidentally sent you Preparation H.
Good whatever to you whenever you are watching this episode of Successful Failures, the show where we, and there, already we have got the Fox Network piping up on my screen, giving a thumbs down to season two of The Critic. They did not like it. After ABC had 13 episodes, they said, get out of here. After 10 episodes, Fox said, get out of here. And thank you for joining me, Spurg Snake. How are you doing today?
Excellent. How about yourself?
Doing pretty well. I do have a date coming up after this. I am, second date, and I will be meeting her husband for the first time. And I do love how fucking odd that my romantic life is. That's why we have some people like Casey Day and Dupa Dupa Doo saying, you need to record this. But married women don't like putting out their freakiness that much. So, maybe we'll get to that one day. So thank you for joining us for this second episode. Thank you, Andrea, super moderator, for coming here once again. And Luigi Greenberg, thank you for reminding me of the crossover episode. I was going to go without just kind of referencing it a little bit. So The Critic, it had a big premiere event over on Fox, a crossover episode from the Simpsons, and then the first episode of the season. And the Simpsons had a big film festival. The final two candidates to win the film festival were Mr. Burns, who bought two of the judges, Krusty, and I forget the other one that he bought, and Barney Gumble, who had a heart-wrenching story about his alcoholism. And then the tiebreaker of Homer Simpson, who he was trying to sway the judges another way. This has become a big old meme, the football in the groin, that Homer Simpson really wanted to win the film festival.
Hans Moleman Productions present Man Getting Hit by Football.
This contest is over. Give that man the $10,000.
This isn't America's funniest home videos.
But the ball is groin. It works at so many levels. Roll it again.
So my ropey loads are doing fine, Luigi Greenberg, but Hans Moleman's ropey loads are now just spurts, unfortunately, after that little incident. And goddamn, is Homer Simpson's laugh infectious? Sam V was talking over on the Spurgtopia Discord about how I don't know what's triggering that thumbs down, but it's fucking great here on this episode.
Yeah, it don't like you.
whatever I'm doing, it does not like it. But Sam V, just seeing the visual of Homer laughing, he was like, I can hear that laugh in my mind. Dan Castellaneta does a great job going over the top. And a great Simpsons episode to lead in to the first episode of The Critic on Fox.
Oh, okay.
But it was a dud. The first two episodes, yeah, I found to be such a dud that I was like, Fox shouldn't have picked up The Critic. They should have gotten the Duke Phillips spinoff show. And that's, as I mentioned last time, Duke, I was such a big fan of in the second watch. And come on, compilation video. There you are. And we were talking, you actually like Franklin a little better than Duke. Duke is your number two, correct?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I like Franklin because, I don't know, it's the way they use him in the show. You know, he's just doing all these non-sequitur things. And
Franklin was helping turn this into a cartoon. Like, yeah, the early seasons of The Simpsons, season one and two, it was basically like an animated sitcom, and they weren't really a cartoon. Season three, they started doing more cartoony things. Season four, all right, we are a wacky cartoon. And
yeah,
Franklin was helping to take The Critic in that direction, to be much more of a cartoon. They had their cartoony moments, but they were really sticking in reality. And as I mentioned last time on season one, the main creative minds behind The Critic were the executive producers, were the showrunners. They had major creative influence over the first three seasons of The Simpsons. And then they went off to do this show that was built around parodies. And that building around parodies, this show would still be on the air to this day, if even with its questionable episodes. But I was setting up this clip of the Duke Phillips show. I've got 3 minutes of a Duke Phillips compilation. Because, yeah, after the first two episodes, I was like, give me more Duke. So here's some fun Duke stuff.
A. Lincoln, pet detective.
47 years ago, and now a rebuttal from the South.
So this is what America really thinks is funny? A talking butt?
A talking butt.
It's nice to meet.
And very much like Homer Simpson's laugh, Homer's hysterical laughter is able to get me to laugh the same as Duke Phillips there with his talking butt.
Yes.
Like, he is a parody of Ted Turner. So I think that would have done however I was going to phrase that sentence, it sounded weird as shit.
More better.
Well, Weller, Peter Weller. But the Duke Phillips show, just parodying Ted Turner, I would have been a big fan of that show. Here we have the two new characters. Fox mandated two new characters. They wanted Jay to have a love interest here in Alice, who was a single mother, and Jay was too pathetic for Fox. Give him a love interest, please. He's too sad. So, and they attached another kid. We already had, yes, Marty Sherman, who was next to useless. So now we have Alice's daughter, Penny, who once again, they kind of just tossed on the kid. So now we've got two kids that are just kind of tossed on, and every once in a while they take place, but it wasn't really a show where they wanted to include kids, except, oh yeah, we've got Marty. Let's have a fat camp episode where he gets thin and becomes popular, which was a fun little episode.
Right. It was a good episode. That's what my notes are. And like you were mentioning, it starts out, that's the first word I use, was unremarkable. The very first episode of season two came off like, much like the last episodes of season two. It's kind of recycled bits from season one. It felt like that's what was left from season one. They were going to go in sort of that direction of giving Jay a love interest. And like you said, it was very much an animated sitcom versus just being an animated show. And Penny and Franklin had a relationship that they were doing. Like, that's what they would always cut to. That's where her daughter always was with Jay's father doing ridiculous things, like running over cars in a monster truck and destroying fine art. That's they were driving through.
That's when Franklin was babysitting her.
Yes.
That they were just going through monster trucks and my iMovie. Yes, the helicopter for the birth of man. And I was trying to pull those, but at some point, my iMovie was overloaded with the amount of clips I was trying to pull, and those ended up on the floor. But, we're talking about Franklin. We could get to some Franklin clips and hanging out with Doris as well. There's an episode where we get Penny going to a preschool because she's just hanging out with Doris all day. And then later Franklin is just causing mass destruction with her. Franklin and Penny actually was a fun little combination of a child and an old man with dementia. So that actually might have been a good combo to hit up more often. That was a fun little dynamic they had there. But we'll return to the Duke compilation, a little bit of the Franklin compilation.
Well, he won't steal the silverware. I've glued that to the ceiling.
This was good.
Dan, I understand the silverware, but why the dog?
You understand the silverware? Cuckoo. I'll go have a word.
Able to come out of his craziness for just a moment of... This makes sense to you? The fuck is wrong with you?
I know, that's why I like him.
He has a certain grasp on his insanity when the joke calls for it.
That's exactly right.
When he's just completely unaware of it, unless the joke calls for it. And he was a very well done character for just being a joke character.
I agree.
I'll go have a word with the captain. A penguin? And he's been drinking. Wait a minute. Penguins can't fly. Penguins can't fly!
It's such a good joke.
That's a fucking great gag. I also had a gag reel when my iMovie crashed. I lost that because they did have some solid gags all throughout this show. And continuing with Franklin, the episode, the will they, won't they, is what they were setting up with Jay and Alice. And by episode 5, they solved the will they, won't they. They will. It seemed like the Sam and Diane, I believe, was kind of the first time that was a thing. And now all the sitcoms do it. So they did a 5-episode arc of will they, won't they. Because they were both attracted to each other, but Alice became his assistant, and she was like, I can't date you if I'm, and then they decided, yes, you're my boss and I can date you. He was both Luigi Greenberg, both dementia and drunk, as we will see from this flashback that he has of how he wooed Eleanor.
One side, you little squirt. I'll have this dance.
Oh, fish! Help! Franklin, help! Help!
So his spinach is gin and booze. Oh, and he has a little song here at the end as well.
I punch like a comet, then drink till I vomit. I'm Franklin the Sailor Man.
So both Luigi Greenberg, and he had a problem with the kids' voices being in the uncanny valley of... I actually didn't have that problem. The problem I did have with Marty Sherman is I could clearly tell that it was Babe the Pig. That was a popular movie around that time. So anytime I heard Marty Sherman speak, I'm hearing la 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 from Pig in the City.
Oh geez. I'm glad those movies gave me a miss. I didn't have that problem.
I was, you were probably a teenager when those came out. I was still of the kids movie age at that point.
That's no excuse. I still watched them most of the time. My sister was around. She's 10 years younger than me, so I got to do a lot of kids stuff in my teenagedom. But I stayed away from live action kids movies. Those always, like, that creeps me out. A talking pig creeps me out. I didn't like Homeward Bound either. It was too sad.
Homeward Bound, and then actually there was the other one with Dudley Moore. Dudley Moore was in the Milo and Otis, who was a regular one that they goofed on. He goofed on a few times in the first one. I thought I had a there we go. Author parodies. I'll bring this up.
I'm hilarious.
I
love the Dudley Moore laugh.
The Dudley Moore laugh, as I mentioned last time, when I was on stage playing a drunken Shakespeare and fell because the amphitheater was wet, what do? Dudley Moore laugh.
It'll get you out of a lot.
And that was one of their regular targets. So here I have a minute of Dudley Moore that they kept going to. I say Dudley Moore, but it was Arthur. They didn't parody 10 at all.
Little Men. Starring the littlest men in Hollywood, Michael J. Fox, Dudley Moore, and Joe Pesci.
Look at this. I'm here with the Keebler Elves.
Oh, you seem awfully hostile. You should see a shrink.
Shrink! Ah. Oh, you think I'm funny? Do I amuse you? Do I make you laugh?
I asked for two shots, but this is ridiculous.
Oh, God, I'll kill myself.
Oh, I'll kill myself.
Foreman.
Pilot. Arthur, a playboy from New York.
Now that's what I call a dry martini. They sent me here to dry.
It's all the same joke, but
every time.
Yeah, but this is ridiculous.
I it wasn't too much for me.
Hey, where are you going, guys? Guys? You are the ugliest flamingo I've ever seen. Oh God, I'm funny.
Speaking of the same joke over and over again, the Easter Island kid. I was compiling all the Easter Island kid jokes, and that's when my iMovie crashed. I'm like, I'm not sifting through it again because I was drunk last night. I was pulling a Franklin by the time that crash happened, and all the Easter Island kid jokes are the same, but I laughed every single time. The joke is he's got an Easter Island statue head.
He can't get in the doorway. He can only do one sit-up. There was another one where he fell, or he was top-heavy. But that was another one of those things where it's just like a surreal moment set in this animated sitcom. You know, like that should, if it was a live-action sitcom and we put the Easter Island head on a human, it might work. But in the animated setting, it definitely works. Especially on the sleepover night when he can't get in the door. It was kind of sad. He's just like, I want to come upstairs.
And every time that his head was too hot, top heavy, and he fell over, there were little rocks, little specks that fell off, and you could see them fly over. So the Dudley Moore gags and the Easter Island kid gags, both same gag over and over again, but worked for me, and it wasn't too much. Like, one day, ropey loads will become, as I was discussing with Luigi Greenberg. It's been 2 weeks since we've started hammering that joke into the ground. And it'll fade away, or I'm just going to keep on doing it until it's not funny any longer.
It'll circle back around. It'll be not funny, and then it'll be funny again.
Possibly. That's one of those.
There we go.
I can't even think of an example of that. How can I not think of an example of that? Better send in Duke Phillips, because I was going to reference a good joke and I can't.
Where's the joke?
Sir, we're on the air.
I know we're on the air, but where's the joke?
It's somewhere out there in the ether, Duke. And that does set us up to return to the compilation of Duke Phillips jokes, where fellow Southerner Alice is meeting Duke in person for the first time. But they've crossed paths before.
Thank you, sir.
I'll never forget the speech you gave at my high school graduation. I just drank two bottles of tequila. My wife doesn't know I'm here. Any of you girls over 18?
I still give that speech today. You know, Southern people like us have to work extra hard here in New York.
I love that he still gives that speech today. All you are young. Some of you are 18. Come on back.
Yep.
Assume we're illiterate country bumpkins.
We're the Bears who sing for doo-doo-dah, drinking moonshine with you.
Oh, the doo-dah. Big, dumb, belching bear.
We're the Bears who sing for doo-doo-dah.
The fact that he can watch it over and over again.
Yeah, and again, it's probably another dig at Ted Turner for being like narrow-minded, but I also thank him for WCW. So,
yeah, once he WCW would still be around to this day if Ted Turner, if his greed hadn't gotten too big. That merger for AOL Time Warner killed WCW, made Vince McMahon a narcissist, and gave him the confidence to have a R room for that poor lady. So,
oh God.
Jamie Kellner, it's your fault that that lady was R'd at work as part of her duties and people just let it go. All your fault, Jamie Kellner, and Ted Turner, your greed got too big for you. You could have stopped all of this, of what happened behind that R room at WWE headquarters.
Awful.
I'm Duke Phillips, and I want you to put this little girl in your school, pronto.
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Leghorn, but we don't have an opening.
You know what he's saying, Duke? He's saying that you can't get the daughter of the assistant to one of your most expendable employees into this preschool.
Is that a compliment or an insult?
An insult.
I've never been so insulted.
Yeah, another one of because this is an allegory, anagram. Well, what the fuck word am I looking for? This is a parody of Ted Turner. So that is that an insult? Is Ted Turner is a dummy? This is Ted Turner. He's a dummy. He doesn't know if he's being insulted. He has to be told.
Yeah, I know. That's what's great about it.
My life.
So what are you going to do? Build your own preschool? Your own preschool. I'd like to see that.
Fun side gag there. Built on a dare. A spite preschool.
I like how in the juxtaposition too, they show his angry face and then it cuts to him being successful on the sign. And then he escorts that guy away. He's like, aw.
And gives him some ice cream that comes out of that Duke Phillips nose.
I wasn't sure if that's what happened. I didn't want to be wrong. But yeah.
Yeah, an ice cream dispenser out of his nose. And the Duke Phillips Television Network used to be a Southern food restaurant. And there's still chicken people just coming up to his office ordering some chicken. And he's got buttered biscuits just right there in his pocket. So some of those restaurant qualities still remain in that big old TV network.
Oh, yeah, that was good. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
You're all good.
Poor kids. They're crazy about each other. If only they had the guts to say how they really feel.
You're right, Duke. I've loved you for years. In fact, every 30 seconds, I have a hot, steamy fantasy about the two of us.
I got to take this elevator.
It's just an open shaft.
It's quicker.
Very upset. And that's the only clip I have of Doris, because once again, my iMovie crashed when I had her trying to blow some smoke rings and a demon forming. Doris.
Yeah, that was a good one. And I think Duke took a cigarette out of her mouth and tried to crumple it up and throw it away. And just another cigarette came out and he pulled that, like, I could do this all day. You know, like, yeah, she just kept lit cigarettes kept coming out of her mouth.
Yeah, an absolute dispenser for already lit cigarettes. And there were two gags of Penny hanging out with Doris, like playing gin or poker. They had two of those before Penny got enrolled in that preschool that Duke built on a dare.
Would you look at these ratings? Ted Turner's killing us. It's that tomahawk chop. Well, I've been working on my own visual.
That's not okay, Duke.
Yeah, his advisor has some questions about this. Well, not some questions, outright objections of of this side.
Well, what do you think?
It's very similar to what the Nazis use, sir.
Oh, do you think they'd mind?
about J. Sherman, sir. He's trapped in Baghdad.
All right.
Yeah, he does look like Michael Jackson.
Looking for that new, that tomahawk chop type of thing that people can do. Michael Jackson, no. And he's very happy. Oh, one of my employees is stuck in the Middle East in the Gulf War. He's my reporter.
Right. Reporting around the clock. What do you think of this gesture?
Sir, I think it's rather wonderful.
This is PNN. Duke, stop that. The best charity is always anonymous.
What about that?
All hail Duke. Duke is life. All hail Duke. Duke is life. All hail. Pigeons seem to like the sound of my...
and once again, Duke is able to get them into some cartoon territory here. So both Duke and Franklin were getting them where they needed to be. As I said, Simpsons, it took them three seasons to transition from animated sitcom to cartoon. So they didn't get that chance here. But here at the end of season two, they started getting towards that. And nice to see you, KB, former guest on Chatting with Beloved Chatters. That gives me a chance to plug anyone who wants to be on Chatting with Beloved Chatters. That has kind of gotten out of rotation, as next week we will have the second episode of the St. Cloud Divorce Show. That is really shot up my subscribers.
Yeah, dude, the first one did pretty good.
Yeah, so we've got some more videos coming from there. Thank you, KB, for joining me on Chatting with Beloved Chatters and joining us back here for this episode of The Critic Season 2. And was the Middle East episode that we just kind of saw. That was a big old dud. They had a few things that seemed like fun in concept of the brown acres, green acres, but in the middle of the desert that...
Yeah,
just more fun in concept than in execution.
The notes for that episode that I have are, we talked about the Easter Island kid. He makes a bit more appearances in this episode because Jay's telling the story back. So all the kids are watching.
We've got one Easter Island kid gag at the when he first shows up. And then he eventually somehow makes it in and he's milling about with the other kids from the United Nations school.
Much like The Rocks, how you said there was a little bit of detail. He was drinking hot cocoa and then he wipes and you can hear it's like sandpaper. It's like, you know, when he wipes his mouth. So he is legit made of stone. And yeah, they tried to work Saddam Hussein into a bunch of old concepts like that, like Brown Acres. And I think there was another...
They had an old John Wayne movie, but it was dubbed over for the Iraqi audience, where they're all denouncing America and just absolutely love Iraq. And I think this last clip here, if I remember correctly, this might go on the board of my Duke Phillips compilation.
Shalom! The ratings just jumped 50% from squat to squat and a half.
When I get above my regular view count, I believe that belongs on the board that I have now got squat and a half watching my live stream. So that was my Duke Phillips compilation. My favorite character, as I mentioned, Franklin was my favorite character as a kid. Second favorite, but yeah, those two top tier. And another thing that was better in concept than execution was the episode, the Duke episode, running for president. I wanted a Duke episode. As I said, after watching two episodes, I was like, this should be the Duke Phillips show, the goofing on Ted Turner show. But the Duke running for president episode, lackluster to me. One of the lesser episodes of season two.
Oh, yeah. It it would turn into a, like, it was just him being a typical politician and then getting outed at the end about what he really wants to do. And it plummeted because of Jay Sherman not writing speeches for him anymore. Like,
yeah, that was
Franklin was doing, he was going to be vice president or something. I can't remember, but he was being forced to pick between his dad running mate. And Duke.
Franklin was going to be the running mate. I think the best joke out of that, the hardest laugh I got, was when there was a running mate debate and they show the other two candidates, and then Franklin, they walk in and Franklin just pops up and they have the perfect sound effect. Whoop. Dumb gag. But when Franklin takes this to a cartoony territory, it absolutely was firing on all cylinders.
Yeah, I very much enjoyed it.
And let's check out a little more from this Franklin compilation.
Hey.
Now, I've given money to the Republicans for years and never asked for anything in return.
You asked to be Secretary of Balloon Doggies.
I didn't ask to be Secretary of Balloon Doggies. The Balloon Doggies demanded it. Isn't that right, Balloon Doggie? No. Shut up.
Oh, Lord.
I can't sleep with that awful...
he's operating the puppet very much like a lot of us in the hackverse dabbleverse, where we haven't learned ventriloquism to throw our voice, so we've just got to be off camera or show our mouth moving or have a spawn mask on. Very intelligent to have that spawn mask on while operating Tukey and 2K and Toki is a CGI puppet, but a lot of relatives of Tukey coming out of the woodwork. I do like Nimrod's variation of the French Tukey. Can see that over on the Cut of the Jib channel, and very fun appearances when we see Tukey coming forward.
He was in trouble.
Oh, yes, 2K was in trouble. We saw that on Hack Rides channel.
That's right. And so I don't know, man. I might have to keep my distance.
Yeah.
I don't need any of that kind of heat on me just yet.
We'll have to just go to the Cut of the Jib channel for 2K since, the heat's on. And hopefully that heat gets off of 2K soon, because a lot of people... looking to get 2K and not in a good way. But here, this clip, Franklin's looking to get himself some Eleanor while they're both up with the grunge neighbor moving in next door and being loud.
Racket.
You know, as long as we're both awake, we could...
Well, you have to come to me.
Maybe tomorrow.
Now I have to interview.
And since we got on the subject of the grunge rocker moving in next door, the writers didn't seem to have an appreciation for grunge rock.
Stop saying grunge rock. It's just grunge.
Obviously, I don't have an appreciation for it either, because I'm not saying it accurately. You killed the genre of hair metal. Those ladies were whores, and then you brought in the ladies who weren't whores in the grunge movement. But the writers didn't seem to appreciate grunge at all. Whereas when they goof on the Southern culture, they do seem to have an appreciation for Hee Haw and Green Acres and the Dancing Bears.
I was just going to say they brought out the Dancing Bears. That's a pull. I can't remember what that's from, but I know it's from something old and Southern that I can't just put my finger on.
It might be the live action bears from Showbiz Pizza. Actually, no, they weren't country bears. I think a Disney ride had the country bear jamboree, possibly.
Yeah, there's something that's related to them that I can't. It's like way back in the spider webs of my brain.
Those are the two things that come to mind of being a direct reference of the country bears, Showbiz Pizza Bears and the Disney ride, possibly. And they're definitely machines. They're drawn to be machines, not like those puppets. Like H&R Puffin Stuff didn't have machine puppets. They were all hand operated or people in suits.
People, yeah. I remember the people suits from HR Puff and stuff.
And I believe we've got one more of the Franklin compilation because Franklin is a fun guy.
Replacements for the butler.
Hello, I'm Mrs. Doubt Franklin. Watch me lose my false teeth and set my bosoms on fire.
Oh, Franklin, you're not fooling anybody.
Oh, I'm sorry, dear. I just did this because I wanted to see the children.
You can see them anytime.
Well, who wants to do that?
That's what I mean. Like, it doesn't. There's always a turn or a twist.
His dementia is just very well done of where his mind goes from wanting this to wanting that in just a quick moment. Absolute silly cartoon character Franklin was. Well done. And he was helping to turn this into a full-on cartoon rather than a sitcom that's animated.
Yeah, that's one of the other things about this show. Sometimes I feel like it, like how you mentioned with the cable guy, it just doesn't commit to a direction enough.
Yes, I agree. The animated direction, the We Are a Cartoon direction, and as I compared earlier to season one and two of The Simpsons, season four is where they're like, we are a cartoon. We are not a sitcom. And it seemed like the second season of The Critic was kind of like the third season of The Simpsons, where they were starting to make that turn, to get that proper identity for this show, which they didn't have at this point. Trying to have this will they, won't they, that they resolve in five episodes, that was a miss.
Right, right. And very much a sitcom trope.
And there were some few other regular targets that they went to, being in the Hackverse, Dabbleverse, so forth, a lot of us are quite familiar with Howard Stern. This gag right here is one that has stuck with me. The cab driver being very amused by Howard Stern. this gag has always stuck with me.
And now, back to the very best of Howard Stern. Now, Robin, here's something else I do on the toilet.
Toilet. Well, Howard, my new album is...
Shut up. Margo, can I see you naked?
Of course not.
Then get out. Robin, what's so funny?
I don't know. I wasn't listening.
The Cockroach King, starring Howard...
And Robin Quivers, I did not realize what a fucking loon she was until listening back to some of that. Like the book that she released, Quivers A Life, Jackie Martling would call it Quivers A Lie. And the relationship with her father does seem to be completely manufactured as more comes out. Like the publisher, I think, got a hold of it. The editor got a hold of Quivers A Life and said, what the fuck is this? Let's just... do a little here, molestation.
Make it spicy.
Yeah, that seems, the more that comes out, it seems like it was just a dull book that Robin turned in, that the fictional parts turned out to be true, that narcissist test. And she was onto the ayahuasca before a lot of us started that ayahuasca trend. Well, actually, I haven't had the ayahuasca, but I do love me some psilocybin.
Agreed. It's that time of year, too.
Oh, yeah, great time of year. I love springtime tripping.
It took me a minute to catch the Jewish thing that was going on in place of the actual Lion King thing. And when I was watching this, I was like, wait, what are they saying?
And then I picked up on that pretty quickly. That was, and they really let this gag run for a while. They're doing a full opening that's lasting like almost a solid minute here. Actually, I guess not, because all these clips got to a minute, but this is going for a while. And not only did he invent the Critic, I invented the Conan O'Brien talking face bit, which is a lie. the producer from the Channel 9 show came up with it, and then he was the producer for Conan. So it's like anything that someone created under the Howard Stern umbrella, Howard is like, I own that. I created that. No, you brought the creator on your show, and then they went on and did it elsewhere.
Right. No, that's a corporate attitude, and I don't like it.
Behold your king.
That's right, I'm your new king. What do you think of that? Hey, baby, show me your thorax.
Same joke every time, too. Get naked.
And they did it only like two or three times over 10 episodes, so it didn't overstay its welcome. Like, I hope Ropey Loads doesn't overstay its welcome, but I have too much fun with that phrase. So hopefully it sticks around for a few months before we run it into the ground.
No, I'm trying to get everybody to say it.
I love that Earl Skakel has now said it a couple episodes. I was able to catch him for the first time last night, and it sounds like you just missed me typing in the chat and Earl Skakel reading back the. He said something along the lines of, "No, I'm not. I'm done with the Dabble Verse. Oh, but I'm not done with Ropey Loads." Something along those lines. Around the 30-minute mark of last night's episode, I'll have to clip it for you.
Yeah, I'll check it out.
Just we'll like I. one of the other regular targets of the critic was Keanu Reeves, which yes. We got into last time, and they kept it going because Keanu Reeves in Bill and Ted was so good that everyone just assumed that's who he was. He's no good as an actor, and not everyone bats a thousand percent. Not everyone bats a thousand. So I'm sure there was a role that he didn't do very well that they were able to feed into. He's just a dummy. He's just Bill. He stinks. Where wildly beloved, The Devil's Advocate. That's one where I think people were saying he lost his accent in the movie. See, he's a shitty actor, but it was
right. The
Devil's influence over Southern Keanu Reeves. It was part of the character that. I'd have to go back and watch that, but I'm pretty sure they don't shoot movies in order. I'm pretty sure it's in order. I don't think he has it, lose it, has it, lose it. It's over the movie. He has it and then it fades away.
Yeah. Right. Good point. I'm going to have to watch that because that's a pretty good movie. I remember liking it.
And Al Pacino, when he was already a parody of himself, Scent of a Woman was another one they parodied a few times. And once again, my iMovie crashed before I was able to pull the two Scent of a Woman. They loved goofing. That was like Al Pacino's turning point of turning into a parody of himself. Yep. And then Heat was another one. Fantastic movie, but great ass.
Right.
Big turning point, despite fucking loving that movie, that one line of great ass was parody Al Pacino coming out during that great performance.
Oh, great. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. And he leaned into it later on, too, because he was, what was it, the Dunkin' Donuts bit from another, I can't remember.
Adam Sandler movie, where he's absolutely playing into parody Al Pacino. But here we have Generation X Keanu Reeves in a couple of roles that they goofed on him with.
Star Trek Generation X.
Space. Big deal.
All right, you two. Who wrote Beavis and Butthead rule on the back of my skull?
Not us, man.
Hey, aren't you the dudes from the...
Christian Slater, Beavis, Keanu Reeves, Butthead. Very very fitting. So, Keanu Reeves is the duller of the two, where Christian Slater is the spaz of the Beavis and Butthead.
Yeah, they get Christian Slater a couple times in this season two.
I didn't pull any of the other Christian Slaters. I didn't find them as fun. But yeah, he was another regular target. But the Keanu Reeves goofing on, I found very fun. So that's why I pulled a couple of those.
Hey, aren't you the dudes from the TV show? You know, that space thing?
Will you please try to stay in character?
Keanu Reeves in Speed Reading.
All right, Hotshot. You think you're so smart? Let's see you read this book. Bogus. If you read under 50 words a minute, this book explodes. Ready? Begin.
One fish.
And it's Dr. Seuss.
Oh, no. Fish. Red.
It's fish, you idiot. Fish.
Dude, now I lost my place.
And it's Dennis Hopper's fault that it was triggered in the first place. That reading per minute never would have gotten to the minimum if it weren't for him. The one episode, Luigi, I forget which one, the Scent of a Wolfman was in season 2. But the You'll Miss My Hoo-Ah, I specifically remember being in L.A.J. It's not on Tubi. I had to go to nefarious means to find the You'll Miss My Hoo-Ah the first time that they did it. And Scent of a Wolfman. How-how-how-how-hoo-ah. I forget exactly which episode that was from, but L.A.J., not on Tubi. You'll have to go to nefarious means to find. Oh, also, Ed Koch came back. How am I doing in this episode as well? He was the big marshmallow man stand-in for Ghost Chasers 3 in L.A.J., which, yeah, I don't know why Tubi's missing one episode, but Tubi's missing that one episode of L.A.J.
That's annoying. It's very annoying. Because at the same time, like you said, I want to know why. Is there like some sort of rights or a legal thing that they just couldn't get one episode? That's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's very random that singular episode is not on Tubi. I noticed that very late when I was making the intro for last episode that, oh, I only have 12 intros of Jay answering the phone. Did they double up? No, they didn't double up. Oh, we're missing Jay going to Los Angeles. That has some fun gags in there, like the assistant. Jay had a fantastic assistant in L.A.J. You're going to go far in this business. No, I won't. I used to be Vanilla Ice. another fun gag that I'm glad that I caught, realizing that it wasn't there. And going to a little bit of nefarious means, we did just see Star Trek Generation X, and William Shatner was another regular target of them. I love goofing on Shatner. That's just always fun.
Hello, I'm William Shatner, and this is Celebrity 911. Tonight, we devote the entire hour to police calls involving James Caan.
Caan!
Great.
The facial reactions, very much right. Like we talked about Duke getting that face of like, oh, you motherfucker. That him starting to flip out there before screaming out Caan. Very good animation.
Caan!
Great party, wouldn't you say? Read my book. Read.
And to set this joke up, this was after introducing the Rosie Perez robot. Rosie Perez was too busy. She was off filming something. So the Rosie Perez robot was out doing publicity at this big celebrity get together.
My book. Read my book.
Hey, there's the William Shatner robot.
No, that's really him.
Don't bogart that juice, Rosie. Raindrops keep falling on my head.
My feet are too big for my bed.
I like that they got Picard in on it, too.
They got Picard a few times. As I mentioned, Hee-Haw, the Next Generation. I believe I pulled that.
Oh, yeah.
Hee-Haw, the Next Generation. They were Star Trek fans. So they got a few hee-haws, a few Star Trek TNG jokes in there. And but before I forget, another plug for a beloved chatter, beloved streamers show, Bobby Nick hosts No Filter with a few regulars and guests Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Saturdays at 7 o'clock. So another beloved chatter, beloved streamer. I've got to drop the beloved when it's not a chatter. The reference is lost at that point. And movies with 2K at 6 this week, watching Ready Player One. I do enjoy the 2K movie reviews almost as much as I enjoy Hee-Haw, The Next Generation.
We interrupt Hee-Haw, The Next Generation, for a special news report. And now, back to our regularly scheduled program.
Dumb gag, but I love it.
There's a couple of good Klingon jokes, too. The one episode when we were referencing the Easter Island kid, there were a couple of Klingon kids in the UN school as well. And they just beamed straight out of the apartment.
When Marty had, that's right. Marty was elected president, student president. And he's like, it's not going to be all fun and games. There's going to be some hard work. And all the kids just abandon him. And the two Klingon kids beam away. But their mother is honorable. She has to beam them back in. What do you say? Thank you for inviting us to the party.
Yeah, it's very angrily, too.
As a Klingon would be. They just show up in the audience, and then through the rest of the episode, the Klingon kids are part of the UN children that are all around.
Good show. What?
I just got a little distracted by chats. I am getting much better at reading the chats and running the show at the same time. Sometimes my brain fart does happen while I'm trying to do those two things at once. So a little brain fart as I was trying to do both those things at once, getting those plugs in for some of our buddies here. And, back to one of their regular targets. We had a lot of fun with Orson Welles last week. And on season one, that review, we watched that commercial where he was drunk and the final product. That was some fun times. I've got to clip that. I need to make clips in general. But that's right there. I was like, that was a lot of fun, taking that detour.
Yeah, no, dude. I was dying because it's just that good.
Watching the final product was a great idea, because seeing him drunk and how they the French, he didn't know when he was supposed to speak, and then the final product, they had to bring him back a different day to voice it over because there was no audio that they could use.
It was so bad. And then, like you said, he was waiting for that woman to talk. He's like, doesn't she have a line? Like he goes action, and they all just sit there for like 3 or 4 seconds, and it's just like,
he kind of shifts his eyes over to her, like, I'm going to go. It's me. So here he is once again, hawking some products during a video. Will.
Hello, that's right. I'm Orson Welles. What follows is a terrifying journey into the world of magic, mystery.
Mr. Welles, this is a video. Will.
What? Look, I don't need to do this. I've got a fish stick commercial in an hour. Oh, what the hell? I need the money.
Poor old Orson Welles, Hollywood royalty, and he had to hawk. Is this fish sticks? He sold the peas. He sold the wine. This fish sticks might be an invention by the writers. I don't recall an actual fish sticks performance.
Close is a terrifying journey into the world of probate, beneficiaries, and goblins.
Mr. Welles.
Fine. Fine, no goblins. I give you the living will.
Yes.
Tales from the Crypt type of font, and it's bleeding.
And remember, there is no fish stick like Mrs. Pell's.
This isn't a commercial.
I know, that was just a declaration of love. Yes. Oh, yes. They're even better raw.
Absolutely, Nimrob. The brain was an impression of Orson Welles. Whenever Maurice LaMarche was doing either the brain or Orson Welles, it was the same voice. And Why'd you go away? A little technical difficulty on my part with the clips. They're back. But the same voice that he used for both. And we mentioned it last time, the episode where they went word for word with him just having just taking the piss out of the commercial. How do you start a sentence like that? You show me a sentence that starts like that, I'll blow you. And Pinky in the Brain recreated that word for word, only switching out "I'll blow you" because they had to get it on children's television.
And Animaniacs was such a great show. That was. They
also were doing a lot of the parody stuff,
right?
That became more the style of the time later, where. The parody style is much more in demand now than it ever was before. And we had these cartoons filling that itch for us, and it was few and far between. I think you're right, Luigi Greenberg. When they call action, Orson Welles, doesn't she do something? I think it was an actual mutter that he had, as well as kind of like looking over.
Orson Welles and the angry Casey Kasem are probably two of the best, like, leaked behind the scenes. This is what these guys are really like, kind of audio.
I also loved the Barry White. Hi, this is Barry White. And he would get so fucking pissed and start yelling, but then take a couple of beats after yelling, "I'm this stupid motherfucker." Hi, this is Barry White. I used to do that in my stand-up act. I would do celebrity rants, and the Christian Bale Terminator Salvation rant took about 5 minutes. So I have a 5-minute set. I'm doing the Christian Bale rant, and seeing the audience realize this is all it is was that used to be a fun thing about movies, of discovering this is what it is. But now you go to Rotten Tomatoes, you read reviews, the trailers tell you exactly what it was. People don't like being surprised anymore. Whereas back in the day, you kind of discovered what it was along the way.
Yes, I agree. And that was part of the fun.
Yes, Nimrod. Sabotage. I don't say sabotage. I say sabotage.
Sabotage.
Well, he tortured. Shatner tortured that poor production assistant where he was like, "Well, why don't you tell me how to do it?" And he's not an actor. He does it very passionless, and Shatner does it in the exact tone that he just did. And he starts really breaking the guy down and torturing him. "Well, you told me that's what you wanted me to do."
I'm going to investigate that one more. Ponderous, man.
The Shatner one of just absolutely torturing that poor production assistant is a fucking classic.
I'm gonna check that out later. For this show that does all these puns, they didn't go with a pun of Orson Welles, like if it was his own company. I don't know why, but that's why I wrote that down. Also, Jay's stomach is a character now in season two more. Which Jay's, I appreciate.
Yes, Jay's stomach, very much like. I don't know if I'm going to get this back. Jay's stomach, very much like Homer Simpson talking to his brain. Jay is talking to his stomach.
I liked it. I wish they would have stuck with a common voice. It kind of changes up from episode to episode. Once it was like a Snaggletooth Hanna-Barbera thing. It's like, "Feed me already." You know, like the exit stage left, like that sort of silly voice. And another time it was a straight up militant voice. Like, "I want that now." And I wish it would have stuck with either one. Preferentially like the militant voice where his stomach is ordering him around more to eat.
And it is kind of fitting, once we brought up the sabotage, that my clips have now been sabotaged, and my connector I've been having trouble with all week I'm going to have to go out and buy another one because it is being a dickhead to me. And I had to, once again, because of the space on my laptop, I wasn't able to save them directly to my laptop like I prefer to do, but instead had to save it onto an external hard drive, and the connector not connecting very well. So,
boom.
Shit. Son of a bitch. Well, we can talk about the episode by episode. Hopefully the clips will come back. It looks like Shatner sabotaged me and took away my clips. How dare you, Mr. Shatner? The episodes, we mentioned last time Jay's sister, Marty Sherman and Jay's sister probably should have been combined into one character.
Right.
And she had the grunge episode. That was her only episode. Marty's episode where he becomes thin, that was his only episode. They didn't get much screen time, and just consolidating that into one character, I think, would have been better for the emotional arc.
I also think that's why they dedicated a whole episode to each character to get that amount of screen time out of the way. Okay, here's a Margo episode, Jay's kid, and then the even with Penny and the preschool, like that
Penny
was...
had her one episode. She was introduced in that dud of a season premiere, very strong Simpsons episode for the season premiere, followed by a dud of a Critic season premiere. And the second episode, the Jay in the Middle East Gulf War, another dud. The grunge episode, that was a fun one. I do love that Marty gets fat just overnight. And they take everything back to normal. His popularity immediately disappears. And
right.
the bullies, they're about to beat up Thin Marty. But then one of them, that's not our way.
Right.
We only make fun of, we only torture those with obvious differences.
Exactly.
And then the little effeminate kid, there we go.
Martin from The Simpsons.
Yeah, clearly exactly the Martin Prince voice.
Tress McNeil, I think that is. I can't remember. And that was another thing about season two. There was a lot of celebrity voices. They got Siskel and Ebert and Rex Ross and Gene Shalit. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was in the last episode along with,
That was from the first season though. That might've been the LAJ episode. If you didn't get to see, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Oh yeah. That was from the clip episode that, okay. Cause he got credited in that episode 10 too. At the very end, because they used him again.
Yeah, they had to pay him again for using that clip in the clip show. The Siskel and Ebert episode was my absolute favorite of the bunch. I had so much fun watching Siskel and Ebert punching it out on the plane, having a full on fight, and then doing auditions. Jay trying to get in there to be their partner, and I will play some clips if my attachment will agree
you
with
broke
me.
The internet, you broke but, it.
sabotage happened over here, so we did have a nice amount of clips, but my connector not working, and it got sabotaged.
The Siskel and Ebert episode was better produced. Like the first episode of season two versus that being the second episode, it was markedly better in production. The color was better. They put effort into it, and right up until episode 9, there were things going on. There was small arcs. Alice's sister ends up marrying
Duke Phillips.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, it looked like she was going to be a regular character going forward. But all we had after that episode was the clip show. That was the tail end of where clip shows were proper and acceptable. So the Simpsons kept that clip show horseshit going way too long for sure. But they were on the tail end of where that was acceptable, having that clip show as the finale.
And they presented it as a clip show. I remember as a kid, them disguising clip shows with a trapped in a freezer or an elevator scenario where two characters that don't have a lot of screen time together, specifically, I think one was Uncle Jesse and Candace Cameron, were stuck in a basement or something somewhere. And they had been arguing throughout the episode. And then it was them reminiscing.
Through clips. Season two ran out of money. Their season finale was a clip show where Riker is stuck inside of his head reliving past events because they just straight up ran out of fucking money.
Right. That sucks, man.
But the clip show of the Critic kind of did make sense of for the format. I think that's kind of what networks and fans were expecting more of the Critic, was being that heavy with the movie and television parodies, because some episodes were really light with the TV and movie parodies.
Right. And I think I mentioned earlier when we were talking in private, this show wasn't designed to be watched in a row either, because it comes off repetitive, because there's so many puns and parodies and movie plays on words. Like, if you start seeing it over and over again, the joke gets run into the ground. But if you're watching an episode or even two episodes a week, it stays fresh. You know what I'm saying? It's very topical.
Yeah, my laptop is absolutely agreeing that when watching these in a row stunk, but the little spoon feeding you these episodes worked out very well back in the day.
Right, and because you would remember, like when they were making fun of Arthur, they did a similar joke two episodes ago. So, you know, it's not as bad as it could have been, but it definitely, the budget started dwindling towards episode 9, episode 10, blah, 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 blah. There were some good shots at the Royals in season 2.
That was another one that was started being one of their regular go-to goofing on Prince Charles. Poison, mommy! I mean, tea!
Oh, you almost got me! And then she hits him with the candlestick.
Who died and made you king?
That was the joke. He was all sad too. It was like, nobody.
Oh, that's when he got kicked out of the preschool, and they realized Penny wasn't going to get in this preschool because not even Prince Charles could get in there.
Right, they kicked him out. I remember putting down the weight loss camp episode. That was kind of a good episode. It seemed like it was a toe the line episode. Okay, we need a G.I. Joe positive message kind of thing, because they were pretty spot on. Like, the better looking you are, the better people are going to treat you, unless you do stuff that makes you memorable. Because at the end, like you said, he gets fat by eating ice cream.
Well, into the night, and the kids are ready to just turn on him again. But he's the star of Peter Pan, and right, trying to fly him up into the air. He fucked the roof all up. His school is closed for a month. So by the way, horse's ass again. Last season, Marty got a horse's ass trophy for coming dead last in the in the UN Olympics. And this season, he was trying to build a float, and all he could make was the horse's ass when all the other kids, hard work.
Ah. Yeah, they all ran away. They bought into buying for the election. That was pretty good too, that episode. He's like, I'm going to be the president of the people. And then he repeated it all to everybody. I think he does say it in Klingon. They were all happy.
Yeah, that's right. One of the Klingons has a retainer too. The child Klingon has a retainer.
Right. Yeah, and it's little things like that get you, you know, if you're paying attention, there's some good stuff in here.
The will they, won't they ended on an episode with Jeremy, the Australian friend of Jay, coming in, and his sister is coming to New York, and they kind of have a romance until Jay realizes, oh, it's Alice I love. Alice seeing Jay with another woman. It's Jay I love. We need to go forth. That was a decent episode. Some fun little Ricky. They both, thanks to Ricky Lake, they were able to figure out who they really love. And Ricky Lake herself coming in and having a little bit of a cameo.
Yeah, another celebrity voice that was that person. That was pretty neat. You know, it was neat to see. And this show is very 90s. So if you grew up around there, or if you know the references that are coming through, there's a lot of nostalgia to be had, especially seeing Howard Stern pop up so many times. You're just like, oh shit, that's right. Dude, he was around.
This was a very New York show. The creators said that this was a love letter to New York, and the ratings in New York were fucking garbage. So New York rejected their love letter.
Yeah, they didn't like it. And if it was a love letter to New York, I honestly don't see it that much either. It's the sets are nice. Their backgrounds and everything that they do, the buildings. When they do that establishing shot in the credits where it says The Critic and you can see the two towers, and that's drawn very well and colored. I think it's watercolor, but I'm not 100%, but it looks really nice. You know, it's got its own style. It doesn't come off like The Simpsons too much, and it doesn't come off like Family Guy.
Jay did get a little bit of a redesign, very slightly, to make him just a little less ugly from season one to season two. If you saw the models back to back, you could see the differences, and they made him just a little less ugly there for season two.
Yeah, and you're right. I agree. I think they were trying to soften up the Jay Sherman character, especially by giving him a love interest.
He was just so pathetic without that love interest. His ex-wife was also a bit less ugly when she showed up a few times, because Jay sucked her soul out in that marriage in the first season. She still hates him in season two, but she doesn't have those dead eyes. And is just dead on the inside in this season.
I like that she tries to voodoo chant his new love interest. She tries to put a curse on him. And then he goes, and the restraining order said no curses. It's something she was actively doing.
Yeah, no warning, no hexes. The judge has decreed it. Those are out of the question. The judge said no mas. Just like my computer is saying no mas.
Yeah, it doesn't like you.
I thought that the thumbs down triggered that. It must be finding something that looks like a thumbs down, or it's just getting into the spirit of The Critic. Because Jay Sherman did say everything stinks. Oh, a B plot that was very fun in this episode was the action star stalking Jay and Jay being scared for his life.
Yes.
Because the action star was like a bad actor. I'll show him.
So, yeah. I think it's supposed to be Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Yes. It's a Jean-Claude type of stand-in instead of Jean-Claude himself.
Right. And he gets him into the alley. He backs him all the way down into the corner of the alley. He has a gun pointed at his face. And he's like, please don't kill me. He's like, you think I'm going to kill you? He's like, yes. He's like, that must make me a good actor then. You know, and then he squirts him in the face with the squirt gun. And then
just like most action stars, I'm as dainty as a daisy.
Yes. Because I think that's a rumor about JCVD too, is that he's a little bit of a... by Curio.
Well, he does do those splits very well, so he can get really spread eagle for his lovers.
He's a fit man, still.
Very fit man to this day. He did that parody series of himself. He's got a nice sense of humor about himself.
That's right. Steven I forgot Cabell. About that show. I need to watch that.
I've only seen a few episodes. I do need to pick back up on that. And yep, it's my connector here. Testing a few other connections. I done broke my connector. I'm gonna have to go out and buy another one so I can play clips for another episode. The ones I really wanted to get to was the Siskel and Ebert plane fight. That really made me giggle. Of Siskel and Ebert getting into a fist fight, and they're on a plane, so there is a liquor bottle for Siskel to break, but it's a little teeny one. He's got to hold it with his,
right,
just three fingers while he is fighting Ebert. And the Jay's trying to get an audition with Siskel and Ebert. Siskel auditions or Ebert auditions a guy, and his face just melts off like in the Raiders of the Lost Ark. And then
I'm trying to remember the other one, and I can't.
Siskel auditions a guy who talks about how Tim Allen is a great actor. Disney makes great films.
That's right.
Even though they don't win awards, it is great for the family. You're the devil, aren't you?
And I'm going to get you this next time. You know, he transforms and says he's going to trick him one of these days.
Indeed, it was Satan who is telling him that Disney is a great company, putting together great films that don't win awards, but are just fantastic for the whole family. You were saying you didn't like the musical number. I got a big old laugh at the Siskel and Ebert musical number at the end of that episode.
And the second one is where Duke chimes in too, right? He has a little bit of a line or two. It's more of an ensemble song versus the first one where it's just Siskel and Ebert singing.
Yeah, the finale, it's actually just one song in that episode with Siskel and Ebert pining for their old partner. And then Duke, he's losing Jay. Jay is going to be the partner of one of these big reviewers. He's going to be off the network. And
that's right.
He's always just absolutely shitting on Jay. But he's tears up because he's losing Jay. And there were two other clips that my technical difficulties are not going to allow me to get to. The running gag of what is beating Jay in the ratings. I find that a fun one. The less fun one was the Monk Variety Hour. The really fun one was the man with his tongue stuck to an ice cube tray. Jay was
that's definitely that's another one of those bits that are good every week, you know, like, because there's always going to be something more ridiculous beating the critic in his own show, and Duke enjoying it more than he enjoys his own show is always funny too.
There's another clip, not what Jay's competing with, but Duke just once again just interrupts his live show on air. People aren't interested in what you think, they're just here for the funny clips. And then he snaps his finger and it has two kitties playing ping pong back and forth.
That's right. Yeah.
I believe that one will be going on my board as well.
That's a good clip.
But luckily we did have a solid hour of clips before my technical difficulties kicked in, and it looks like they're sticking around. And I got this wet, and I was trying to multiply it, is what I was trying to do. I wanted a second one, so I poured water on it. And who knew electronic devices don't like water?
Go figure. And then somebody's going to put a comment later, put it in a bag of rice. So
I think it's too late for that. This was a couple days ago, and then I thought it fixed itself, but she appears to be dead.
It's just a power USB hub. You'll be fine. Like $10.
Technical difficulties ever. Indeed. There were more clips to come, but the worst technical difficulties ever have put an end to those, making this closer to a 60-90 minute show than a 2-hour one this week for sure.
Well, there's not as much to talk about. There's more of the same from season one to season two. Not a lot, but it still has its beats that, whoa, careful, now look at you. You're out of control today.
Yeah, I'm going to get some water on more electronical equipment and just fuck everything up.
I made a note about a joke that I can't remember what it is, because I was a little tipsy myself watching some of these episodes, but it was the kids smoke and sex equals arrested. I don't remember.
Remember that. That one is a really fun one where Jay is investigating where his parents make their money, and it's cigarette executive. If I'm not allowed to sell cigarettes to kids, what are they going to do after they have sex?
That's
if encouraging kids to have sex and smoke cigarettes is illegal, lock me up.
And then they cut to him in the paddy wagon. That's what it was. Thank you. And Alice's sister goes on a date with Jeremy, the Australian. And he refers to her as Date. Like, that's her name. So how are you feeling tonight, Date? You know, like that. Like she's not a person. She's just Date, you know? So I like that joke, too.
And Luigi Greenberg, yeah, if you go on IMDb, it says there's three seasons. There is an online third season. It was on adamfilms.com. Those episodes were like less than 5 minutes apiece. John Lovitz came back, but there's no returning characters other than that. So the rich tapestry of side characters are not there. He's got a new assistant that's just some lady. No Duke Phillips, no Franklin. So our favorite parts just aren't there in the on the online season of The Critic. So it does have the parodies. It just takes it down to the most simplistic part of having the parodies of modern movies in that third online season.
I had no idea that even existed. Otherwise, I'd tried to look it up and have something to say about it.
What sticks with me most about that online season is that at some point Jay is talks directly, basically directly to the audience, of saying, the vast majority of my audience is 14-year-old virgins. And I was exactly a 14-year-old virgin when I was watching that. I was watching it with other people as well. So,
yeah, everybody
really got me good there, Mr. Sherman, Mr. Lovitz.
He does a couple of fourth wall breaks in the season too. And John Lovitz himself makes a couple appearances. He walks through a party, and then Jay Sherman says, "Oh, I wish I was as good looking as him."
And John Lovitz comes through just very full of himself. It is what I've actually heard John Lovitz is like in real life, that he's just completely full of himself. So he was poking fun of himself, but he's still that guy, even though he was poking fun at him being completely full of himself.
I wonder if that's why he didn't get more stuff in Hollywood or other Lorne Michaels vehicles for himself. Because after High School High, I don't remember much from him.
There was some movie that he did during Saturday Night Live that Lorne Michaels was upset at him for taking. Ooh. And didn't allow him to come back after he needed a little bit of break to finish up the movie. But High School High in like 95, 96, that was his only starring role. And it's really hard to get another role like that if you prove that you're not a box office draw. And that was a big old bomb, High School High. Norm Macdonald was lucky enough to get a second try after Dirty Work wasn't a big success and screwed the movie. But Norm got two, and then they were like, "Yeah, we're done with you." Whereas, John Lovitz, his one, didn't get his second starring role.
Yeah, that's so bad, man. Because he's a funny guy. But if you're full of yourself and you're a dick to people, nobody wants to work with you. I love
that people clued me in on the Kevin Smith drama with him of him trying to skim something off the top of the Kevin Smith podcast for just filming in his comedy club. So he was trying to take a bit too much of the pie in his feud with Kevin Smith. And he has turned into an old lesbian. When you see him nowadays, he has fully transformed. Without transitioning, he has transformed into an old lesbian.
Awful. It's happening to Kevin Brennan, too. He's turning into an old grandma. Or has.
He's had that attitude for quite a while. And the bald head is... actually, that's not saving him from turning into a grandma. He just looks like cancer patient, dry drunk grandma.
Yes, that's correct. That's 100% correct. Oh, God.
So that was the Critic season two. My technical difficulties fucked up some more fun clips I had for you, but we did get the review done of a very hit or miss season. Two duds off the bat. They really needed to come out swinging. That Simpsons crossover episode where it premiered on, fucking fantastic Simpsons episode with man getting hit by football. the Jay in the Middle East, more fun in concept than in execution. And then they did have a bunch of good episodes there in the middle, but ending on a clip show, and the Duke running for president episode, another one that I'm like, okay, this is going to be great. But yeah, we've just seen it before and seen it since of the political candidate. It was two by the numbers, that Duke yeah. running for president episode. We were talking about the Marty student president, the other plot in that episode, much more. We enjoyed that. But the Duke, yeah, not a solid season. So with only 10 episodes and having a few duds in there, it is easy to see why Fox was able to pass on this for another season.
Right. And it's hard to work in everything you want to work in. And the other things that we don't know, what got cut, what got pushed out because they didn't want it to be this style of cartoon. You know, they want it to be more like The Simpsons and less like its own thing, or, you know,
the network is always pushing for a family and a kid. Qbert in Futurama was pushed on them. Marty Sherman himself might have been pushed on him by the network, and then the next network pushes on another kid.
Another one.
Marty was next to useless and really should have been just one character in Margo. Kevin Brennan looking like Leukemia B. Arthur from Nimrob. Yes.
I'm going to do a face swap with Maude and Kevin Brennan.
And then there's Kevin. And then there's Kevin. Luigi Greenberg has been looking for a clip of Lovitz on the reality show, The Girls Next Door. I'm unfamiliar with that. The Girls Next Door. Was that the Playboy reality show?
I have no idea.
Apparently he was on there, and we done missed whatever the fuck he was doing on there. And let me just give one more try to see if I can get. Nope. If my computer had more room, I wouldn't have it here on this external hard drive. But because of the limited amount of room, I'm editing too many things at once right now in my iMovie is the problem. That's taking up too much space. So fun clips that I presented up front, missed a few more fun clips, but we did give our opinions on the Critic season two here. And
yeah, that's what everybody wants, right? Opinions. I got plenty.
Yes. people like assholes. People like opinions. And we've got both of them. We got two assholes. Send in Duke Phillips. Just winding up for a joke there.
Where's the joke? Sir, we're on the air. I know we're on the air, but where's the joke?
And that will forever stay on my board. That and Major League's Just a Bit Outside were the two I was thinking of for when I miss a joke. And
Bob Uecker.
Yeah, but one hit. That's all we got was one goddamn hit.
We're on the air.
No one's listening anyway. Yeah, Bob Uecker has some good drops as well that I was thinking of putting on my board, but never did. So it was the Playboy show, which John Lovitz made an appearance in. And one starring role, one lead in High School High, one TV lead role here in the Critic. And I think we went over it all. Sorry that me and my computer were being a tard and we didn't get to all the clips I wanted to present. But we did have a solid hour of clips before the sabotage occurred.
Sabotage.
Yeah, talking about those, the Shatner just absolutely destroying the spirit of that guy.
Yeah, I don't think I've heard that, man. I got to go listen. That's going to be a fun treat for after the show.
Why not make that part of the show? I will look that up right now. We had Orson Welles. Last
week. We'll do Shatner this week. Okay.
Yeah. I'll go look up for this now as we vamp. And we vamp for a little bit as I search on the YouTubes for the Shatner outtakes.
There was somebody else on that Ricky Lake episode too that did voice work, and I can't remember who it was.
Queen Latifah.
That's what it was. That's what that word is. Queen.
Queen Latifah came in when Alice is professing her love. Queen Latifah, it's a love triangle between Jay, Alice, and Lady Hawk is the name of the episode. Jeremy's sister, and then Queen Latifah sticks her head in to make it like a love square. This isn't the right office.
Denzel's room.
It's when she's in Jay's brain. In Jay's brain, Ricky Lake is hosting Who Does Jay Really Love? And Queen Latifah comes in again. And this isn't Denzel Washington's fantasy.
Right.
Then we have what's funny is the version of Alice. All it is a Jack in the Box. Hers is really quick of Who Do I Love? Whereas Jay's was much more convoluted trying to find his love.
There was a good joke too. It's like, oh, you have latent homosexual attractions to your friend Jeremy. That's why you're dating his sister. And then then her face changes a bunch of times. And I can't remember
Spartacus. Yeah, good enough.
He called me Spartacus.
Being gay is a running gag. Duke Phillips is convinced that he is a gay man and he cannot be told otherwise. So
he sees the fantasy of the village people. I'm not gay. And then he turns them into like all of the.
YMCA. Here, Dr. Moonrat is the YouTube channel who animated the William Shatner outtakes of Sabotage. So a little bonus, whereas Orson Welles last week, William Shatner this week.
Ooh, animated.
This is William Shatner, and I would like to invite you to take a journey with me into the 21st century. So take the next few minutes and listen very closely. You'll be amazed at what you hear. Okay?
Can there be a little more excitement in the beginning?
Okay, I think this one's different than the Sabotage one. So there are multiple William Shatner being an ass to the people who are trying to produce him. This one's my favorite. I believe Sabotage is another one. I fucking love this one.
I love it. Okay. All right.
It sounded like really laid, you know, really super laid back.
Well, I'm saying, okay, I'll try and do that. Let's do take two.
He's pissed.
Yeah, that chuckle. Yeah, he's not very happy at all.
He kind of stumbled over himself as in his mind, he's thinking, is this guy fucking serious? And then that laugh instead of screaming at him. But he is going to take another route. Rather than screaming at him, he will torture him in another way.
This is William Shatner, and I would like to invite you to take a journey with me into the 21st century. So take the next few minutes and listen very closely.
Speak up.
And maybe.
Oh, he's stepping into a bear trap at this point. The bear trap has just snapped on him. Speak up. let it out. Get ready to be pummeled by me verbally.
Take the next few minutes and listen very closely.
Speak up.
And maybe you better do it the way you hear it. Do it for me. No, I mean, just go ahead.
This is William Shatner, and I would like to invite you to take a journey with me into the 21st century. So take the next few minutes and listen very closely. You'll be amazed at what you hear.
Is that the way you'd like me to do it? Okay, ready.
Oh, boy. He just got direction. I will do it exactly as you just said.
This is William Shatner, and I would like to invite you to take a journey with me into the...
Oh, and they got this from the Stern Show. We can hear Fred Norris laughing there.
Okay, that's
21st
that
century.
Yeah, that was definitely Fred Norris laugh. So this is not a clean cut that our buddy Dr. Moonrat got here, but he has animated it for us.
Yeah, I'll take it.
And I would like to invite you to take a journey with me into the 21st century. So take the next few minutes and listen very closely. You'll be amazed at what you hear.
Very robotic. You'll be amazed.
I think that came pretty close.
Exactly as he asked for. Because that guy wasn't an actor. He gave it very monotone because that's just his voice.
That's the only way he knows how to do it. Yeah, exactly.
He's
Mr. Blue Sky.
He walked directly into this tar pit of William Shatner.
Are you making fun of me?
Fun of me?
I believe that you asked that was about the way you did it. I wasn't jesting.
That was the way he did it. No, what do you mean? You wanted it done that way. I did it that way.
I'm sorry. I don't know.
No, I insist. Now, what I want you to do is on pay. Is that satisfactory to you?
Maybe I should have just kept my mouth shut.
No, because if your mouth were open, you'd have popped some pills in them. So do the next paragraph for me, page 2.
Well, I don't know. I really don't want to, because I think you're
trashy. No, stop hitting me, Mr. Shatner. You are verbally beating me into a KO. No more. No more.
That's good, dude. It's so good.
No,
I need you to do it. You did it so well the first time, and I took your direction, and it improved. You do it one more time.
I really don't want to, because I think you actually have a better, much better view.
No, I don't think I do. I would like to hear you read the second paragraph, so I can do it that way.
You know, now that I looked at the different things you did, I really like the first one.
No, I like it better the way you did.
Son of a bitch, dude.
And he could have yelled at him and dressed him down, but this is cutting that guy much deeper.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah, he made the engineer realize that he was should have had kept his mouth shut and just let William Shatner do William Shatner, you know, just let him read it.
And he's trying to tap out, this engineer, but we still have another minute to go. William Shatner says, no, we're going another round, buddy.
I mean it. Please read play so I can get an idea of what you want. No, I'm going to do it the way you think it should go. No, I am going to do it the way you're reading it. Okay? I know you're here to see that I do it the way the company wants it, so I'm going to do it the way you read it.
I don't want you to do it.
But you're telling me how you want me to do it.
Well, I'm sorry.
No. I am going to do it your way. No, there's no apology necessary. You know what you want. You know what you want.
No, I don't. I really don't.
I mean, you come in here and you don't know what you want?
Well, I come in here because I know you're a professional. I mean, and you know how to do it. And I'm sorry I even said anything.
No, I am going to do it the way you want. Every paragraph. And you'll send it back to town and you'll see whether, I hope it will please everybody else. As long as I'm pleasing you, that's all that matters.
Mr. Shatner, would you please, I don't feel right about doing that.
He sounds like he's on the verge of tears at this point.
Yes. Yeah, no, he got this guy. This makes me respect William Shatner a little more because he's being very devious about how he picks this guy apart. No, I'll just do it. I'm doing it the way you want it done because the company told you how I should be doing it. And you're going to do that so I can repeat it the way you want me to do it. And this guy's just like, fuck, man. But just, he wants to get to his coffee break. That's it. Now.
Well, no, you felt you wanted something done on the first paragraph. I'm trying to do what you want. Okay, let's lay down the second paragraph.
And that's where it's cut off. Thank you for that animation, Dr. Moonrat.
That was, I did like that too.
That was a fun adaptation. that I guess we do not have that as a clean version. We've got Fred Norris laughing. Nimrod hadn't heard that particular one. The sabotage is a different one. Sabotage. I say sabotage. And just fucking torturing the guy. So two seasons of The Critic, and it got canceled. My connector got canceled halfway through this. We didn't even get to the woke James Bond or the woke Roseanne. As we were talking about last episode, the politically correct textbooks. When is he going to get here? He or she? All is lost. There was some before woke was a thing. There was some making fun of the wokeness with a few others. Political correctness kind of tiptoeing in the 90s. Before
infancy, people really will believe stomping. That Christopher Columbus discovered America. Oh, what was it? There was a quick Roseanne one where they were like trying to, my lesbian girlfriend wants to move into the basement, and then like the John Goodman was like,
the Gulf War episode with the kids having a big sleepover, and they're playing these violent video games. No video games. Let's watch some wholesome ABC television.
That's right. It was a jab at ABC. And they cut to Roseanne, which wasn't.
My lesbian something wants to, can she stay in the basement? No TV, no video games.
Yep, right.
And that must have been what kicked off his Gulf War story. So, out of an episode, but we there were some little parts that were fun of that, as we've been discussing. There were some little fun parts, even though it was a dud. And yeah, coming out of the box with that first episode and that Gulf War episode, a bad choice. Yeah. I wish the Siskel and Ebert episode would have been more upfront. I think coming with that foot forward might have gotten them another season, possibly. Because yeah, two duds out of the box on a new network, not a good sign.
Yep, fair enough. And like I mentioned before, if you're trying to watch it like on Tubi or something, it's going to come off repetitive. It's going to play episode after episode, and you're like, oh, this is just like the last episode. But it's not.
The first season seemed a bit more repetitive. As I mentioned with the Jay and his mother, that happened twice. Duke trying to find a replacement for Jay, that happened twice in the first season. It did feel repetitive, but a little less so in the second season than the first season. They were getting better about that.
Overall structure of the story was better. But it's the running gags that come off as repetitive, like all the puns and the movie parodies. But they did kind of thin it out during some of the more meatier episodes with story, like the camp one and
Jay cleaning up New York City. That was my other favorite one, the Siskel and Ebert episode. Them fighting on the plane. That's the biggest clip that I'm disappointed that this took a shit on. I laughed so much at the Siskel and Ebert fist fight on the plane, and then the episode with Jay's parents getting stuck on the desert island. Jay cleans up New York. One of my favorite gags of him taking a hose to the public library. The L comes off. It's the public library. Yay!
And then everybody comes back out, and they're all disappointed. Was it Mr. Greenberg that was asking, was it dementia or alcohol? When they were trapped on the island, he didn't have as much alcohol, and he did it up. He made like a hut.
Virile.
Right, right.
Eleanor his hair was came ready back to hang him.
Yeah. It was really... So that was a cute little episode too. I really enjoyed, like you said, there's bits and pieces that really stand out, and then there's other things that just kind of fall flat, or who is this for? Kind of lack of edginess or a seemingly forced kind of perennial message, you know.
The undoing of Jay completely cleaning up New York. just, we're going to throw you a Tinker Tay Parade, trash out the window, streamers,
yeah, that's right,
overturning the car, just immediately undone.
Undoing by it all, yeah. Tinker Tay Parade.
So that was The Critic. Good in concept, but not executed as well as it could have been. There are shining moments, execution. There are shining episodes, but the batting average for season 1 and 2 for only having 23 episodes wasn't strong. It had too many duds. The duds had some fun moments in it, very much like this the Steel Toe Morning Show, having the Clippers sift through all that garbage to find the good parts. The duds did have some gold in them, and a big thanks to all you Clippers. I've got one from Hackverse Anonymous, My Lost Interest, and I'm currently searching Spurgtopia for Sam V's clips. Those will be featured on the next St. Cloud Divorce Show, coming at you next week, Wednesday or Thursday. I will finalize that with you soon. And okay. For the next episode of Successful Failures, I am trying to get a guest. Haven't heard back yet. Got a message. Nope, that's our buddy Luigi Greenberg sending me a link. Next week, if we have a guest, it'll be one thing. I guess our fallback could be Dark Place. You mentioned Garth Marenghi's Dark Place to me, and that only has 6 episodes. I've fucking love Dark Place. So
yeah, I'm a huge fan of Dark Place, and I think I asked if you watched. It had a spinoff show called Man to Man with Dean Lerner, who was the production.
Yeah, he was like the
producer. I'm sorry, I couldn't think of the word. But yeah, when they were doing the interviews and stuff, and if we do get into Garth Marenghi, we'll get into Man to Man as well, I hope.
We don't have a lot of episodes, so that will be coming up either in 2 weeks or in 4 weeks. If the guest doesn't come through and talk about some puppets, they had a puppet show that they wanted to talk about, and so that will be a little surprise if it pops up before Garth Marenghi, but definitely looking forward to Garth Marenghi coming up on Successful Failures. And a puppet show from the late 90s, early aughts. Some of you know what I'm talking about already. We've got a guest that wants to come on for that one, and just waiting for confirmation on that one. So we've got 2 weeks for that confirmation. Otherwise, I'm always down for some Garth Marenghi.
Sounds like a plan.
So, thank you for joining me. Be back next week with Tommy for the St. Cloud Divorce Show. And then in 2 weeks for another Successful Failures with either a puppet show or an oddball British show. Let's get out some plugs before I thank you all and send you on your way. Spurgtopia is over on Discord. You can find me and Tommy bullshitting and a lot of other people. I mentioned Sam V, the mayor of Spurgtopia. Thank you, Sam V, for sifting through the Steel Toe garbage for us and posting some gold. He's I could hate watch the Angry Video Game Nerd podcast. I was disappointed when that went off the air. I loved hate watching that. I cannot hate watch Steel Toe. Can't do it.
Garth Marenghi. Yeah, I can't spell it. Luigi had a comment. We're usually hanging out and Spurgtopia discord.gg Spurgtopia. There's your Discord, you said, being Discord, a little more active in there, trying to get some stuff going.
Trying to make that post at least one thing a day. I'm posting alternative Simpsons memes when I don't post videos up there. And Garth Marenghi's Dark Place was a BBC show. It came on Adult Swim, and I think there's like all of 6 episodes. So that's why we're calling that one the fallback, because that will be an easy one to do if the guest does not confirm in time for us to watch the 13. We don't even need to watch all of the puppet show, just some of it to get a taste, so we have something to talk about for 60 to 90 minutes.
It's a good show. It was another one that probably would have done better had it been in better timing, like in a better timing situation.
Very much like the Critic, even with its flaws, the current want of the mass public for parodies, even though it had some stumbles, if it came out a few years later, those parody segments would have carried it to a good 5, 6, maybe even 20 seasons if it came out just a bit later, because that's what the public is much more about now, is they want something familiar. They want something they've seen before.
The member berries. A little
different, as seen by all the remakes.
Yep, and I feel like the Critic failed so Family Guy could be more successful later on.
The cutaways in the Critic were kind of built into the narrative, whereas the cutaways on Family Guy just remember that time. So that was they walked so Family Guy could run drunkenly down with their cutaway gags.
Yeah, no, the Siskel and Ebert fight is akin to the Chicken Peter fight.
And they're kind of the monster on the wing. They fight the plane, and they're fighting on the wing of the plane. And Jay's disgusting face looking out at them gets them to stop and hug each other.
Good show. Very good show.
Yes, you can watch that over on Tubi for free. Tubi has no memberships, so the Critic can be checked out for free. They're just missing LAJ, and that is one of my more favorite episodes, LAJ from season one. But as I mentioned, season two, the Siskel and Ebert episode, and which other one did I recommend a bunch? Alice's sister coming in. It was a fun one. Episode 9 and episode 4. There's
Grunge Rock. Nuns in a Blender was the band.
The season finale of season one, it was the second time they did the Jay and his mother have a problem episode, and it was much more well done than the first one. So,
right.
Don't watch them all in a row. As we said, it kind of isn't designed for binging, which also is a thing of today. Also kind of stops it from being modern, but good stuff in there. Even the bad ones have some good stuff sprinkled in.
Agreed. Absolutely. Lots of good jokes.
So I was wrapping up and then I stopped. So I am going to wrap up once again. And thank you all for joining. And
ropey loads.
Getting in a ropey loads before we get out of here. Luigi Greenberg and I are big fans of ropey loads. Just don't get it in our face. That's all we ask. That would be a problem. So thank you all for joining. Now feel free to go away.
Good night, Critic fans, and a special good night to those of you just tuning in for Home Improvement.
Bye for now.
Toodaloo. Au revoir. Auf Wiedersehen. Ciao. Ding dong day.
All join hands, circle left. Now circle right and listen to me, Ellis, Ellis, MFT. Alan, mend your corners like swinging on a gate. To right, dear honey, with a right to left eight. Grand right and left around you go. Lucky strike means fine tobacco. Meet your honey and give her a whirl. All swing around with the little girls. Smoke 'em, then you'll see. Ellis, Ellis, MFT. Promenade and don't you fall, promenade around the hall. Lucky strike is first again with tobacco men. Promenade straight down the pike, it's time right now for a lucky strike. Yes, for smoking that you're bound to like, you just can't beat a lucky strike.